We thank you, Jesus, for making this teaching extremely simple and easy with practical examples in a very simple way, that this mystery is revealed to us, which was mystery for ages and generations. Thank you, Jesus, that we realize now that Christ is in us and your Spirit is one with us. Lord, you speak to us, you know exactly what we need and what we are going through. Help us, Lord, so that we change our thinking, renew our mind, so that our life is completely transformed, so that we live a life that you have called us to life, to be the light of this world. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Praise
in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Praise you, Jesus.
Praise you, Jesus.
Love you, Jesus.
Love you, Jesus.
So, are you understanding spirit, soul, and body? The spirit part is where we have become a new creation. Everything that the Lord has given us, that's why if you see any scripture in the New Testament after the resurrection of Christ is in the past tense. Put Ephesians chapter 1 verse 3. Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who will bless us, who will bless us, who will bless us, who will bless us, who has blessed us with some spiritual blessings, with some spiritual blessings. Now, is the scripture making sense? With all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in
Christ.
In
Christ.
In
Christ.
Now, where is Christ? Where is Christ? In us. I think it's 1 John 4:17. Can you put that? 1 John 4:17? Love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in the heaven. As he is, so we will become in this world. So is it very clear? As he is, so are we in this world. Yes, that's the mystery. Christ in us. As he is, so are we in this world. Say this: as Christ is,
as Christ is,
so am I.
So am I
in this world.
In this world.
As Christ is.
As Christ is.
So am I.
So am I
in this world.
In this world.
That's why the one who is in me is greater than the one who is in the world. Now Ephesians 1:3 says, Christ has blessed me with every spiritual blessings in the heavenly, that is in Christ. And exactly what is in Christ is in me. Christ is in me. So every blessing is where? In you. Not some blessings, every blessings. But for me to see the blessings to manifest, I have to renew my mind. You see, any scripture after the resurrection, it's in the future tense. By his stripes we were healed. Christ has redeemed us. Galatians 3:13. Romans 8:2. Christ has set us free. The law of life in Christ Jesus has set us free. Everything is done. But the problem is, we are seeking it outside. Put that John chapter 4. John chapter 4. Put verse 1 and come out. I want to see 10th verse. Or, and come out. Yeah, 10th verse. Put the 10th verse. Jesus answered, said unto her, if you know the gift of God, and who is it that says to you, give me to drink, you would have asked of him, and he would have given you living water. Next verse. From the woman said unto him, sir, thou hast nothing to draw within, and the well is deep. And the well is
deep.
Now the Samaritan woman, Jesus meets the Samaritan woman. What happened? Okay, you can't see. Okay. Only thing, don't
stand.
It's okay, you can sit there, no problem. Okay?
Thank you.
Okay. Now here we see the Samaritan woman. Who was the Samaritan woman? The outcast. Yes? The Jew have nothing to do with the Samaritans. Because the Samaritans are the people who got mixed married with the Gentiles. And the Jew always considered the Samaritan the outcast. Now Jesus, his main mission is not actually to preach, his main mission is to go to the cross. Because only when he go to the cross and take the sin on the cross, a curse on the cross, then the gospel is for everyone, for the Greek and the Gentile. Correct? But on the way, he meets the Samaritan. He loves everyone. There is, it's not that Jesus came, some people say the promise was only given for the Jew, God loves only the Jew. No, God used Abraham as an instrument so that through that he can make a covenant, so that through that Jesus can come and die, so that the whole world will receive salvation. Now, this woman who came at that time, afternoon time, Jesus is asking her for water. And that woman is so surprised. How can a Jew ask me for a drink? First of all, she is being rejected because of her lifestyle. That's why she has come at that time, not when everyone comes. And secondly, this man is a Jew. Usually the Jews look down at the Samaritans, and they have nothing to do with the Samaritans. But Jesus, the first thing he does is, he is asking a drink from that woman. That itself is an act of respect. For a Jew to request a Samaritan a help, that was shocking for her. How can a Jew speak to me, first of all? Speaking is different, but how can he ask help from me? That's what attracted her. Now, did Jesus straight away come and say, you are a sinner? You're wrong? You are living a wrong life? No. The first thing Jesus did is, he expressed the love and acceptance that he has for her, no matter who she is. Correct? That pulled her attention. And the woman said unto him, sir, thou have nothing to draw with. Because Jesus is promising her that he is giving her. Okay, go back to the previous verse. Go back to 9th verse. See this. Then says the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that you being a Jew ask drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? It really shook her. You know, God has put us in this world, you know why? Not for us to be like others, to point others and judge others, but to be different. That the people in this world who don't know Christ will get attracted. How is that? You can love, you can accept. How can you, at this condition, can love me? That's how the gospel has to be preached. And that's what happened to the Samaritan. How is that you being a Jew ask drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. Now put the next verse. Jesus answered and said unto her, if you know the gift of God, what is the gift of God? Salvation. Is there a price that we have to pay? Who paid the price?
Jesus.
He himself paid. That's why it's a gift. There is a difference between a reward and a gift. A price and a gift. A reward has to be earned. Yes? It has to be performed. But salvation is based on not my performance, it's based on God's performance. That's why it's a mystery. It's a gift from God. It's given to us because He loves me. When do you give gift for somebody? Will you tell that somebody, you do this work, I'll give you a gift. If you do this task, I'll give you a gift. It's not gift. It's a reward for the work that they have done. But gift you give out of love. So salvation is a gift. That means God is telling that woman, you might be living a sinful life. Maybe the people have rejected you. Because you are a Samaritan, the Jews has rejected you. Because you are a sinful woman, Samaritan has rejected you. You have messed up your life. But I am ready. God is giving you a gift. You can receive this gift not by your performance, but by believing. Did we see in Romans chapter 10 verse 12? How can a person be saved? By believing. And how can a person believe? By hearing. And how can a person can hear? By the preaching of the gospel. Yes? And that's what Jesus is saying. Jesus answered and said unto her, if you know the gift of God, the gift of God, the salvation, and who it is that says to you, give me to drink, you would have asked of him and he would have given you living water. What is that water? The word of God. Put that next word, next scripture. The woman says unto him, Sir, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is, and the well is
deep,
and the well is
deep,
and the well is
deep.
From whence then? Where then you have you that living water? That means, how are you going to draw the water if you don't have anything to draw, and the water is
deep.
And the water is
deep.
And the water is
deep.
Yeah, next. Are you greater than our father Jacob? You know what she's saying? My father Jacob is the one who built. Yeah, the forefather, father Jacob, has built this well. And generation of generation, we are drinking water from this well. Do you mean that you're greater than him? Yes, Jesus is greater than him. Now he has to prove it, that he is greater than him. Are you greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle? Next. Jesus answered and said unto her, Whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. Whosoever shall drinketh of this water shall thirst again. You know what water is this talking about?
Yeah.
About the world. You know, that woman, she has 5 husbands, and the one she's living now is not her husband. She is trying to quench her thirst going into a different relationship. Some people, they go and achieve and achieve and achieve. They go into Olympics, they go, they get awards, they get, yes? But if you go and see the person who has achieved something big and got the award, that day he would have felt like, I achieved something. You go and ask him the next day, there is still a vacant in his heart. You might think, oh, if I study this, I'll be, you know, I achieve something. Then after you say, no, I have to get the job. Then after you say, no, I have to get married. Then after you get married, no, I have 1 children. After, nothing is going to satisfy you. It goes on and on and on. Nothing in this world is going to quench the thirst that is in you. We are searching and seeking at the wrong place, at the wrong relationship. We are searching in this world. We think this will satisfy my quench, this will satisfy my quench, and this will. And I go and taste everything, but nothing is satisfying the quench that is within me. And that's what Jesus is saying. All that you're trying in this world, that water that you drink of this world, is not going to quench the thirst. No. Put the next verse. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. Now watch this. But, you know why the word but? He has given you the water, but the water that I shall give him shall be in him as a well of water. springing up into everlasting life. Now, even though God has given us the living water, it is in the well, and the well is the... And where is the well? In the spirit. Is it given in the heaven or in him? But the water that I shall give, this is before Jesus' resurrection. That's why he's saying, I shall give. Yes? But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. The day we are born again, there is a spiritual well that is put in us, that is in our spirit. And in that well, everything is put that we need. The thirst that we have cannot be quenched from the things of this world. The thirst that we have can be only quenched a person who learns to draw the water out from the well that is in us. Shall I repeat?
Yes.
The thirst that we have cannot be quenched by the things of this world. It can be money, it can be relationship, it can be drugs, it can be education, it can be beauty, it can be achievement, it can be sports. That's why people go crazy. But at last, they come to a conclusion that there is an emptiness inside. Because none of these things can quench the thirst that is in us. But Jesus is saying that I have given you the living water. The one who drinks it will never thirst. But the water that I shall give you, shall give him, shall be in him a well of springing, a well of water springing up into everlasting life. Now, where is everlasting life? If I ask everlasting life, will people say living everlasting? No. Everlasting life is not living forever. Everybody is going to live forever, either in heaven or hell or hell. Anyway, but the everlasting life, the eternal life Jesus is speaking about is Christ in us. Springing up into everlasting life. It's inside, it's within. Eternal life is Christ in us. A person experiencing Christ in this earth. As he is, so are we in this world. We always think it's after heaven. Jesus is, after I die, go to heaven. But the Bible says no. As he is, so are you in this world. But the water is deep. The water is deep. Now, I haven't seen in Malaysia wells. Do you have well?
Yeah, we used to.
Yes.
No,
Malaysia.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Okay. So, how do you draw water from the well? There's a pulley.
Yeah, there is
a pulley.
So you put the bucket down, and then it goes down.
Yes.
And then you shake, and the bubbles come.
Yes.
And the water go inside. Then you pull it back. Then you leave your both your hand and take them.
No.
You have to hold it with one hand.
Yes.
And take it with the other hand. In the same way, even though there is a well in you, we have to learn how to draw it out. Proverbs 20 verse 5. Like deep water, but a man of understanding will draw it out. So is the water deep in? When you take the word of God and study the word, the Holy Spirit is the one who's counseling us through the word. And when you get understanding, what is the meaning of the word understanding? Understanding. What is the meaning of the word understand? Wait. Oh, you are turning and searching for the notes. Understand. 2 marks question. Sister Filwa? Understand means, I know you know the answer. Let me see it. Understand? Okay. Getting somewhere close. Practical working knowledge. Understand means to have practical working knowledge. To understand means to have practical working knowledge. How many of you have a smartphone? Okay, take your smartphone out. I'll teach you what is understanding. No teaching anyone and no peeping into others' phone. Okay? No teaching, huh? Everyone. Show your smartphone. Where's your smartphone? Did not bring. Good. Where is your smartphone? Ah, he's having it. Where's your smartphone? Everyone nowadays has smartphone, nobody has other phones. What she's thinking? She's thinking her phone is not smartphone? What happened? It's okay, she doesn't know. Now what? Now take your keypad where you save somebody's number. No smartphone? Take your keypad and show me. Those who took. Yeah. Those who know, don't teach anyone. Okay? Don't show and don't peep. She went. She got escaped. I want her to come. Sister Karen, how much ever long time you are going to take, I am not going to start until you come. Okay, I'll give. Did you take your contacts?
Contacts.
Keep it.
Okay.
Show me.
I think this one.
Okay, now save the number. Plus.
What number?
I'm giving you a phone number, save. Yeah. Plus. No zero. Plus. 9, 1. Now how many of you did not get plus?
I didn't get plus.
You did not get plus. You also did not get plus. All those who did not get plus, give your phone to me. It's a duplicate phone. There is no plus in your phone. There is plus, but it's not coming. Now, you did not get, right?
Yeah.
Don't teach. I told, don't teach. Brother, you taught him, right? Did he get it? Did he teach you? I told you not to teach. Now. Do you have a zero? Yeah. Keep pressing on the zero. Now, do you have a zero? Keep pressing on the zero. Now, you can see the plus, but you did not have the understanding how it works. That's why many of them, when they save the number, they don't put plus. They put zero and they save. Why? Because they did not have understanding. What is understanding? To have practical working knowledge. Now you got the practical working knowledge?
Yeah.
Really? You know why I called you? Because I know with you we can learn. Yeah? It is a fear that you don't know. But once you learn, everything is like that. Once you get the understanding, now you know it. That's all. It's simple. But if you ask your daughter, she will say, Mommy, give it to me, I'll do it for you. Because she doesn't want you to have understanding. You ask your children, can you do this? They won't show you. They will take the phone and they will do and give. Because if you see, you also will get the understanding. Tired of, because it takes time for them to understand.
Yeah, no, time takes time for them to explain.
Explain. So it's better to do and give it. What happens, you know, same way. Now. When the parents come and ask the children will never show how to do. Why? Because they don't want to sit and explain how it works. Correct? So the children will do and give. But every time you want, you have to go to that person and say, please do this for me. Correct? But if they will take little more time and teach you and make you understand, now do you need to go to that person every time? No. In the same way, when you have a problem, don't go to a person and say, pray for me. Better, if you ask that person, pray for me, they will pray for you. But again, when you get a problem, you have to go to them and say, can you pray for me? Better take some time and ask, please teach me. Now, when the person is taught, when you teach the person, when you learn, now when you get a problem, you don't need to go to the preacher. You know how to fix it. But sometimes we are lazy. Why I have to sit and study and write and... Let me go and tell, pray for me. Pray nicely, huh? Pray over me. Pray for my son, pray for my husband, pray for my family. What you will do? I will sit and watch the TV series. You do the praying part, I will do the enjoying part. How do we feel, you know? Lord, we know that we are going to keep them in the bondage and they're saying, please pray for me, please pray for me. If you really want to see result, we have to learn how to draw out from the well. And the well is not there up, the well is here in us. The one with understanding will draw it out. Understanding is not reading the Bible. Hello. It's not going and sitting for mass and listening and coming. If you really want to study, don't just listen. Go and sit and study. When you study, then you apply. When you apply, only then you get understanding. Practice. Tell your neighbor, practice. Now when you practice and renew your mind, that is the time you see what is in you manifesting. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So is the well in the heaven or in you?
Yes.
So you are going to ask Holy Spirit, please come and touch me, Lord. Heal me, Lord. Pour your spirit on me, Lord. When I sing the song, I don't imagine from here coming here. I imagine according to the word of God. I better stick to this. I don't know about others. I better stick. I get results. If you don't want to believe, that's your problem. But as long as I'm going to stick to the word of God, I'm seeing the result. If I'm going to imagine the power going to come from up, nothing is happening. I'm only emotionally crying and singing. Nothing is happening. But when I renew my mind and I learn how to draw it out, I'm seeing result. When the word is truth, the word will bring result. If you want to make out your own theology, then you don't get result. The man with understanding will draw it out. Understanding means to have practical working knowledge. That's why if you see every session we have practical demonstration. We are not just preaching, we are showing practically how to draw that water out. The healing that is already in you. How long you want to take water from my well? How long you are going to allow the neighbor to come and take water from your well? Better teach them to take water from their own well. Praise the Lord. Looks like he understands better than you. Not here. Every session we go, everywhere we go, we see the children understanding better. That's why we tell the parents, that's why I told you don't sit up, bring, come inside, because he is going to miss. I don't know about you. In one meeting recently in Goa, the baby was there and playing, and some of them were getting irritated. Why is this mother coming and sitting? And I, when I saw the irritation in the face, I told them that it looks like he is playing, but he is more attentive than you. Because children, they don't sit like you. They are not designed like that. But they are designed, how you know? Even though they are playing, they are very attentive. It looks like at home they are playing. No, they are attentive to every word that you are speaking. And they are attentive to everything that you do. You don't tell the children, do this, do this. You live and show, then they pick up from us. The problem is what we say and what we act is not matching. We are the one who are planting wrong seeds in our children. Yes or no?
Yes.
When I was saying that, okay, even though he is playing, he is attentive. After a few minutes, I was asking a question, nobody answered, he answered. Just like him, maybe little bigger than him. No, same age. He answered. It looked like he is paying more attention than. I'm saying you the truth.
You said something just now, right before the break. He repeated what you said.
Yeah. Yeah.
The mother was holding him here. He repeated exactly what you said.
I'm
here to preach.
Preach. Praise the Lord. True, it's true. You know, there was one day we had a meeting in a house for 1 week. That house opened the meeting for 1 week as a retreat. Okay? Even the parish priest came, he also, with his approval, we did it. And end of the week we had in the church. Okay. So every day we have, because there are so many people and we had only 1 week, so the person said we will use the maximum. So from morning till night we had batches coming and going for 1 week in the house. It was so beautiful. And you know, the person opened the door. The first day, the parents have come. They have, you know, seated for the session. The children are inside playing. And suddenly, one child screams. You know, something had happened. So everybody got up to see, and that girl is, you know, she was actually a challenged, mentally challenged person. She is screaming, and you can see blood everywhere. Just imagine, they have come for the first time for a meeting like this. And all the other children are panicked. What happened was, one small boy, by mistake, he banged, but there was a keychain. So it hit. It was only a small cut. It was not a big, deep cut. It was a small cut. It scratched, but the blood came out. So it looked like something did happen. Then when I went, I said nothing to worry, because I understood that the hit is small, but it's only the blood and the fear. Seeing the blood, that child is screaming. So we prayed and we took the child to the hospital. Doctor said nothing, but the meeting continued. The next day, when the meeting was happening, these children, instead of playing inside, they slowly came to the living room, and one is standing and watching like this, and the other is coming and standing like this, okay? After some time, I saw they sitting and paying attention. By evening, they all are sitting where, you know, in the first row. Really. From the next day onwards, they all came with their notebooks. They became so, you know, interested in the word. By the end of the week, when we had service in the church, for 2.5 hours, nobody turned here and there, and the father got amazed, the priest got amazed. How is that these children sitting in the first row? All the first 2-3 rows are children. I have the picture, when I, during the break, I'll search and I'll show you. Nobody is turning here, nobody is turning there. Now, how can you say my children are not listening, they're not coming? It's we who are not exposing. But when the word is really preached, when the truth is preached, it is the Spirit of God that attracts them. When I was in Sri Lanka, we had a meeting in the lawyer's office. And there, the lawyer's granddaughter was there. Small girl. Maybe 2 years. You know how she's sitting in the session? And everybody is looking at her. Why she is looking at me like this, as if she understands anything? You may not understand, but the child can sense the Spirit of God. That's why we don't say, don't bring your children. We say, please bring your children. Whether you are getting it or not, they are getting it. When you are in trouble, they will teach you. It is we who are, what we are doing, putting the TV, cartoon, say watch. Don't even know what's coming in the cartoon. And then we say, my son is all the time in the video game. Who planted this seed? Parents. Because why? Because we want to be free, so we want to give them something and make them engaged. But you don't know what is coming. It might look like a cartoon, but you don't know what spirit they are allowing inside. It might look like a video game, but you don't know what spirit is being the person has opened door for. Remember last week, that boy who came and gave testimony? That boy was having a problem. He was behaving violently. And the mother came to me and she asked me, you know, my son he's a very nice person by heart. We know that. He's a very good boy. But all of a sudden, he behaves very different. And we know that it's not he. We can see that it's something else. You know, we can see that. I asked her a question. Tell me the truth. Is there anything that you're watching on the TV or your children or something? Is there any game or particular video game or a video or something? Then she said, yes. We started watching Indonesian horror movies. And I asked her, if you are going to watch all that, are you not allowing the seed to be planted in your heart? Yeah. We only say, yeah, my son is like that, he doesn't listen, he doesn't do that, but from where it came? Which words we receive, that spirit is taking control of our life. If I'm going to take the word of God, then I'm going to allow the word of God to control my life. You don't need to tell your child, listen, listen, listen. But if you are getting up every day and speaking the scriptures day and night, if you are going to play the word of God day and night, the children will get addicted to that spirit of God, the word of God. Now they want to be in the presence of God. They want to be at church. They want to come for a treat. My nephew is now third standard. Two or three of my nephews. If you ask them, their whole passion is to do something for God. There's one nephew at the age of 4, he spoke in tongues. At the age of 4. Now I think he's in 6th standard or something. And he listens to all the teachings. He doesn't get a chance to come. But he listens to all the teachings. He studies. And he wants to give the gospel to others in some or the other way. There's one more nephew. He is in the 2nd standard. And he is asking the mother, okay, when is my next growth retreat? If the growth retreat is delayed, you cry. No. Because these children from childhood, the mother would carry and come, even night vigil they would sleep there. They are so used to hear the word of God. You know, my father, in the beginning he was tough, not now, in the beginning. This fellow, when he comes, because he calls my father grandfather, so when my dad goes there, he sees to that, he'll open the mouth and say, Hallelujah, praise the Lord, thank you Jesus. He won't leave my father. And my father has to obey him. No other chance. No other way. And what he does, you know, he has a mic, a plastic mic. He takes that mic and he starts preaching and healing. When he had dengue, the doctor said his blood, dengue is a dengue. Okay, we call it dengue. Okay, dengue. When he had, the blood counts went very low. And that was the time he opened his mouth and he started to speak, in the name of Jesus, I command the sickness to leave my body. Within 2 days, he became completely normal. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Praise you, Jesus.
Praise you, Jesus.
So what are we exposing our children? That boy, I said, who spoke to that sickness. Every day, he would see the parents have stuck so many scriptures. They are speaking it day and night. When he was very small, he started reading big, big words, all this difficult English. I'm wondering, from where did you learn to read all this? Because the auntie is writing and he's giving dictating. She missed the notes, so he's dictating. So how he's dictating? He's seeing the board and dictating and she's writing. And I'm like, how can you read this? I asked the mother, how is that he's reading this? No, because every day we are confessing the scripture, so by now he learned it. Very obedient, very loving, sharing. They're very different from other children. I see in my family, you know, when the growth retreat comes, my family is there. I could see the children are very different from this world. Why? Because the parents are, there's no TV. There's no video games. The body is healthy, the mind is healthy, they're obedient, they're loving, they're matured. When they came for the growth retreat, it was very cold over there, okay? 12 degree, 13 degree. We all are wearing sweater, but that boy, he's not wearing sweater. The mother has brought the full pant. He said no. Why? Because he's not feeling cold. His body is stronger than the elders. And 10 days he has to be inside. There is no way to go out. There is no way to go for shopping. Nothing. but he enjoys to be there, sleep there. And that baby, the second son, now recently born, we had the growth rate in the month of January. That baby is 3 months or 4 months. And the mother took the baby and came for the 10 days retreat. Okay? Now where is the baby? 12 degree. And where? The retreat house. Till what time is the meeting? Till night. And where is the baby? Nobody can hear even a sound of that baby crying. Only when the baby is taken to the room, then he cries. When he is in the retreat, no crying. 3 months old baby. Because that baby has been trained to be in the presence of God right from childhood. For them, it is normal and peaceful to be in God's presence. I told you there was one boy who used to pray in tongues. When he started to pray in tongues when he was 4 years, right? When he was born, okay? The mother was in depression when he was in the mother's womb. So when he was born, he will keep on crying and crying and crying for no reason. Suppose if he is at home and somebody comes, he would see them and cry. He will stop the room only if the mother carries him and goes inside the room and locks. Even if the mother is going to take the baby and go somewhere, he won't stop. So every time she has to go inside the room and lock herself. The baby was so insecure that the baby couldn't come out. Now we all went for the retreat. That was the first time we all got the bus retreat where I gave my life to Christ. When we went for that meeting, 5 days, the gospel was preached. After that day, he stopped his crying completely. And he's such a happy child. What healed the child? The word of God. The presence of God. No matter what we have gone through, no matter what happened when you are in your mother's womb, but the day the word is preached, the Spirit of God, he destroys every seed that was planted from the conception. It's time for us to come back. Because we are so busy in the things of the world. The competition is, my son has to be first in the class. My daughter has to come first. Have to get the best job. Have to get the best position. Have to get the good salary. Now all this will come. But what if you don't teach your child to have a relationship with God? If you don't give the taste of the word of God? No use. But if they are going to fail, I failed in my education. I failed every year. I was a zero. But praise God, one thing my mother hold on to, Jesus. First thing they gave importance was for God. Now, even though everything was lost, the Bible says when you seek God and His kingdom first, everything else will be added. That's what Romans 12:2 says. Put that Romans 12:2. And be not conformed to this world. Don't be like this world. Don't see the world and imitate them. Don't pick up the habits from the world. Don't see what they are doing. Do we do that?
Yeah.
When we make decisions, we based on the people, how the world do. Yes or no? And be not conformed. Don't take the shape, don't take the form of this world. Don't don't pick up the habits. Don't behave like them. But be you transformed by the renewing of your mind. It's time for us to change our way we think. Instead of thinking the way the people think, let's take the scripture and think according to the word of God. Put that Romans chapter 8 verse 4. Romans chapter 8 verse 4. Okay, put one first. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. When you are in Christ Jesus, when we are in Christ Jesus, then there is no condemnation. Then there is no condemnation. Now, when I am in Christ, then there is no. That means what? You have no condemnation? The devil doesn't condemn you? Hello? The devil is not condemning you? Will God condemn you?
No.
No. But the devil condemns you?
Yes.
Now, if you read the ask, only the first part, then nothing. You have to read it fully. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Put that spiritual body, that circle. As long as I'm going to be governed by my flesh, the devil is going to condemn us. But the person who is going to be walking by the Spirit, that means renewing the mind and changing the thinking, now the devil cannot come anywhere close to you. The devil cannot beat you. Now God is not going to condemn us. If you have made a mistake, God is not the one who condemns. But when we walk according to the flesh, we are opening the doors to the devil. And that's the time the devil is beating us. But the devil can beat you only in your soul and your body, not your spirit. But those who walk by the Spirit, there is no condemnation. So are you walking by the Spirit or walking by the flesh? As long as you are going to use your senses, you are going to learn things. If you are going to be conformed to this world, if you are going to see the things of this world, if you are going to change your thinking according to this world, then you are going to allow those thoughts. Do not be conformed to this world. Do not be conformed to this world. Don't think like the people in this world. If you are going to think according to the people, if you are going to make decision according to the world, then there is surely condemnation. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Praise you, Jesus.
Praise you, Jesus.
Are you understanding now? God is not the one who is going to punish us. God is not the one who is going to beat you, but the devil is going to beat you, condemn you. But only if we walk in the flesh. Flesh is when my thinking is aligned or my thinking is going against the word of God. Put that Romans 8 1. There is therefore now no. Oh, I did not put it full, okay. Okay. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh. That means you can be in Christ Jesus and walk after the flesh. Correct? I can be in Christ and yet walk in the flesh. If I am going to be in Christ, that means my spirit in Christ, and if I am going to walk by flesh, and that means I opened the door for the enemy to attack me. Therefore, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Now put the fifth verse. Now watch this. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh. Flesh means it's not talking about your spirit, it's talking about your mind. Where is my mind focused on? Where is my thinking focused on? How a man thinks in his heart, so is he. Is the Bible very clear? Is it given very clearly?
Yes.
Only thing, we have to take it and study it. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. So now it is your mind that has to choose whether you are going to receive the Spirit of God or you are going to align your mind with the flesh, the things that you see, hear, smell and taste. That is going to determine your soul, my soul. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. Now see the next verse. For to be carnally minded is death. Carnal, what happened? What is carnally? Carnally means flesh. Flesh. Carnal means flesh. Carnal mind means the mind that is contradicting the things based on the world. The mind that thinks that is against the word of God.
The mind fed by the word.
Carnally mind.
Carnal mind is fed by the world.
World. World. If my mind is carnal, then all that I experience is death. Poverty is death. Sickness is death. Loneliness is death. Depression is death. Fear is death. Now, death is... Are you experiencing death or life? It depends on your mind. It doesn't depend on God. That's the problem. We think all depends on Him. But Jesus is saying, no, I have given. The living water is in you. The well is in you. Everything is given to you. Now you have to choose whether you are going to renew your mind, get the understanding, change your thinking and draw the water out and experience the living water, or you are going to align your mind carnally according to the people, according to the news in the TV, according to what you learn from others, according to everything that is contradicting the word of God, then you are going to experience death. It depends on God or it depends on your mind. Hello? Is it too heavy? Sleepy? Should I give a break? Yeah? Should I give a break? Everybody is like,
pass around the tickets at the sides. The sour things.
Okay, okay. 5 minutes break? Yeah? Yes? Okay. Thank you, Lord. Okay, I don't want to. Thank you, Jesus. You know when I'm asking questions and everybody's inside they are sleeping and outside they are. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Lord, we thank you for teaching us these truths and making it very simple for us. Now we realize that you have given us everything and the well is inside of us, but it depends on my mind. Am I carnally minded or spiritually minded? Help us, Lord, so that we change the way that we think, so that we renew our mind. Thank you, Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.